Today it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Atsuki Fukutani. Dr. Fukutani completed his PhD degree in sports science at Waseda University, Japan in 2013. In his PhD thesis, he studied post-activation potentiation, which is a phenomenon by which the force exerted by a muscle is increased due to contractile history of the muscle from previous contraction. In early 2016, Atsuki received a postdoctoral funding from Japan and flew to Calgary to start his stint as a postdoctoral scholar with Dr. Walter Herzog. In general, Atsuki is interested in muscle contraction, muscle architecture, and biomechanics, and is currently studying muscle contractile properties in vivo and in vitro. In his free time, though, Atsuki enjoys studying muscle contraction, muscle architecture, and biomechanics. But in all seriousness, Atsuki spends his free time recruiting fast twitch fibers by doing resistance training. Last year, Atsuki gave a talk, and he said that in the seminar, his goal was to bench press 100 kilograms. And today I can tell you that Atsuki did achieve his goal this year of benching 100 kilograms. But not only did he achieve this goal, he could do 6 reps with 100 kilograms for the bench press. But the one drawback of this goal, though, is that it was quite pricey. And in fact, Atsuki spent the majority of his monthly budget on buying supplements. With all his experience in building muscle, Atsuki will tell us today about his work on one intriguing question in muscle mechanics. Does residual force enhancement contribute to stretch shortening cycle?
Thank you for your introduction. So today, I'd like to introduce my research about the influence of residual force enhancement on the stretch shortening cycle. So first, I briefly explain the phenomenon of stretch shortening cycle. So before conducting a main movement, concentric contraction, so we usually use counter movement, eccentric contraction. So due to this counter movement, human performance is enhanced. So this phenomenon is called stretch shortening cycle. So currently, following factor are considered to be the mechanism of enhanced performance by stretch shortening cycle. The most frequently mentioned mechanisms are stretch reflex and tendon elongation. But today, I focus on this factor, which may be related to the residual force enhancement. So these are the today's presentation. So before introducing my research, so I briefly introduce the discovery of Tai Ching, which is related to the residual force enhancement, and then introduce my own research. So now, so we know that so muscle contraction is induced by the sliding of actin filament relative to the myosin filament. So in other words, muscle contractor protein do not shorten and lengthen during muscle contraction. However, so before 1954, the people believed that muscle contractor protein should shorten and lengthen during muscle contraction, like a spring. And this idea is partly related to the finding by Saint Gerich and his student, Strauss. So Saint Gerich made a mince from rabbit muscle, and when he adds the ATP to this mince, this means shortened like this. So the Saint Gerich realized that the ATP initiate muscle contractions. But at this time, the actin filament had not been found yet. So this means included both myosin and actin filament. So Saint Gerich and his student Strauss tried to isolate the pure myosin filament. But so after isolating a pure myosin filament, they added the ATP, but this pure myosin filament did not shorten. But when they added the rest of mince to the pure myosin filament, this mixed mince shortened. So based on this finding, St. George named this left of mince as actin, because this mince activate myosin filament. So when he found the myosin and actin filament, so people have believed that muscle contractor protein shorten and lengthen during muscle contraction. However, about 10 years later, Andrew Huxley and Hugh Huxley found that muscle contractor protein do not shorten and lengthen during muscle contraction, and instead slide past each other, resulting in an overall shortening of muscle. So this concept is called sliding filament theory. This finding had a very big impact on the field of muscle research, because people had believed that muscle contractor protein shorten and lengthen during muscle contraction. So at the same time in Japan, this Japanese researcher, Dr. Maruyama, read their paper, and he had a question. So if the sliding filament theory is correct, muscle fiber should be separated and never return to the original length when muscle fiber are stretched. So if there are no muscle membrane. So those days, another muscle researcher, Dr. Natori, tried to develop a skin fiber setup, so, which is also called Natori fiber. So skin fiber means muscle fiber without muscle membrane. So Dr. Natori tried to eliminate the muscle membrane mechanically. So after he successfully developed the skin fiber system, so he conducted a very simple but very interesting experiment. So he prepared a single muscle fiber, and then he partially eliminated the muscle membrane, this region B. So, and then he stretched this muscle sample. Because muscle membrane was partially eliminated only in this region B should be elongated more compared to the region A. But the result was surprising. The magnitude of elongation of region A and region B is basically similar. So based on this finding, so Dr. Natori speculated that an elastic element should exist in the muscle fiber, inside the muscle fiber. So this study strongly motivated the Dr. Maruyama, and Dr. Maruyama tried to identify this elastic element. So he chemically eliminates the actin and myosin filament, and he stretched the muscle fiber. And according to the length stretching and shortening, this elastic element also lengthen and shorten. So based on his Dr. Maruyama's original hypothesis, so he named this new filament as connectin, because this filament connects the myosin and the actin filament. However, unfortunately, at the same time, another researcher, Dr. Wang, identified the same protein with different method. So Dr. Wang found the same protein based on the molecular size, so using electrophoretic analysis. So he named it Taichin. So now the word of Taichin is widely used, but so it is clear from Dr. Maruyama's experiment that so Taichin has a elasticity. Okay, now I introduce my own research examining the influence of shortening performed after inducing residual force enhancement to clarify whether residual force enhancement contributes to the stretch shortening cycle. So first, I'd like to introduce the phenomenon of residual force enhancement. This black line shows reference isometric contraction, and this red line shows residual force enhancement trial. So according to the force length relationship, isometric force here should be the same because mass length is same between condition. However, isometric force is larger in this residual force enhancement trial. So this increased force is defined as a residual force enhancement. And residual force enhancement is induced by eccentric contraction. Although the ample phenomenological evidence has been accumulated, the precise mechanism of residual force enhancement has not been clarified. So, in the normal state, this titanium filament produces elastic force as a function of muscle length. However, in the residual force enhancement state, the part of titanium filament attached to the actin filament, so this region cannot elongate more. So instead, this region, this blue region, has to be elongated more at a given muscle fiber length. So the effective stiffness of titanium filament increases. And elastic force produced by titanium increases. So this increased elastic force may explain the phenomenon of residual force enhancement. So although some researchers propose another mechanism, but we can strongly say that at least in part, structural component contribute to the residual force enhancement. This is because residual force enhancement was observed even if muscle length is beyond the cross-bridge overlap. In other words, residual force enhancement was observed even if there were no cross-bridge interaction. So according to the characteristic of residual force enhancement, that residual force enhancement is induced by eccentric contraction. It would be natural to speculate that residual force enhancement contributes to the stress shortening cycle because the stress shortening cycle includes eccentric contraction. So this idea is partly supported by this study. So the effect of residual force enhancement is basically long-lasting. At least, it continues several seconds. So in the case of stretch shortening cycle, main movement is conducted immediately after the end of eccentric contraction. So it seems to be natural to speculate that residual force enhancement can contribute to the subsequent contractions. However, this assumption is held if the shortening performed after eccentric contraction does not affect residual force enhancement. In concrete, in this study, muscle length was kept after inducing residual force enhancement. On the other hand, in the case of stress shortening cycle, muscles are shortened after inducing residual force enhancement. So if this shortening eliminates the effect of residual force enhancement, so we cannot expect the contribution of residual force enhancement. The previous study examined this point. So this dotted line shows reference isometric contraction. And this line shows stretch and shortening cycle condition. And regrettably, this study suggests that the effect of residual force enhancement disappears after shortening. So the effect of residual force enhancement on the stretch shortening cycle may not be expected. But another important finding of this study is the isometric force here was smaller in the stretch and shortening cycle trial compared to the reference isometric trial. So if this shortening just eliminates the effect of residual force enhancement, isometric force here should be the same according to the force length relationship. So this result indicates that this shortening has not only eliminating effect, but also depressant effect. So this depressant effect is called as residual force depression. So once muscles are shortened, isometric force after shortening becomes smaller compared to the reference isometric contraction. So due to this negative effect of residual force depression, the effect of laser force enhancement would disappear by shortening. However, the interpretation is a little bit complicated. because there are two possible explanations why the effect of laser force enhancement disappeared after shortening. The possibility one is the effect of laser force depression, which is induced by shortening, cancels out the effect of laser force enhancement. So in other words, the effect of laser force enhancement still exists even after shortening, but cancelled out by the effect of laser force depression. And possibility two is the effect of laser force enhancement is eliminated by shortening. So the purpose of this study was to clarify the effect of shortening on the laser force enhancement by isolating the above two possibilities. So to isolate the two possibilities, so I adopted very quick shortening step. This is because the magnitude of laser force depression is known to be smaller when the mechanical work during shortening phase is smaller. So if we conduct a very quick shortening step, which is completed within 1 millisecond, the force drops dramatically during shortening phase. So the mechanical work should become very small. So the influence of laser force depression can be minimized. So in this study, so I used a skin fiber preparation. But skinning procedure was different from mechanical skinning procedure developed by old Japanese researcher, Dr. Natori. So after harvesting muscle, so I put them into the glycerol. So glycerol dissolves the connective tissue, so muscle membrane. So this muscle sample is called glycerinated muscle, which was developed by St. George, who found the myosin and actin filament. And isolated muscle fiber was immersed in the chamber, and muscle contractions were induced by changing solution, included calcium ion and ATP. And muscle length and sarcomere length was measured by the diffraction angle of laser beam. So before doing the main test, so I conducted preliminary test to examine whether our quick shortening step induce laser force depression or not. So this red line shows reference isometric contraction, and this blue line shows quick shortening step condition. And I confirmed that laser force depression was not induced by our quick shortening step. So this result guarantees that if the effect of laser force enhancement is eliminated by this quick shortening step, this eliminating effect can be considered to be caused by shortening itself, not interaction with the effect of laser force depression. Okay. So in the main test, so I conducted two different magnitudes of shortening. So in test one, I adopted 1% of fiber length shortening. And shortening was conducted immediately after the end of stretch. And in each condition, reference isometric contraction was conducted to calculate the magnitude of laser force enhancement. And the magnitude of laser force enhancement was compared between normal laser force enhancement condition and laser force enhancement after 1% shortening condition. In test 2, so I adopted relatively large shortening, 12.5% of fiber length shortening. The basic protocol was same with test 1. So I compared the magnitude of laser force enhancement between normal laser force enhancement condition and laser force enhancement after 12.5% shortening condition. And as a result, in the case of small shortening, the magnitude of lateral force enhancement was not decreased compared to the normal lateral force enhancement condition. On the other hand, in the case of relatively large shortening condition, the magnitude of lateral force enhancement decreased compared to the normal lateral force enhancement condition. So we confirm that lateral force enhancement decreased by shortening as a magnitude dependent manner. And because in our preliminary test, we confirmed that quick shortening step did not induce lateral force depression, so this decreased lateral force enhancement should be caused by shortening itself. So based on these results, the effect of lateral force enhancement on the stress shortening cycle seems to be limited. So to clarify this point, so I compared isometric force before stress shortening cycle and after stress shortening cycle. And we confirmed that larger isometric force after stress shortening cycle. So this result suggests that the effect of lateral force enhancement still existed to some extent after stress shortening cycle. So in other words, effect of lateral force enhancement can contribute to the stress shortening cycle. So next, I conducted additional experiment to confirm whether lateral force enhancement contributes to the stress shortening cycle. So here, so I'd like to introduce the characteristics of lateral force enhancement. The magnitude of lateral force enhancement is larger when the magnitude of stretch becomes larger. So based on these characteristics, one might speculate that if lateral force enhancement really contributes to the stretch shortening cycle, the contribution of lateral force enhancement must become larger in larger stretch condition. So to confirm this point, so I conducted a stretch shortening cycle trial with different stretch magnitude. So according to the characteristics of lateral force enhancement, larger magnitude of lateral force enhancement should be induced in large stretch condition. So we compare the effect of lateral force enhancement on the stretch shortening cycle between different stretch magnitude condition. So first, I confirm that the force at the end of active stretch was larger in larger stretch condition. So according to the cross-bridge theory, force length relationship and force velocity relationship, so this result is very strange because muscle length and muscle stretch velocity were identical between conditions. So this result can be explained by the effect of lateral force enhancement. As mentioned before, larger magnitude of lateral force enhancement should be induced in larger stretch condition. So this larger magnitude of lateral force enhancement lead to the larger force at the end of active stretch. So this result guarantees that larger magnitude of lateral force enhancement should be induced in larger stretch condition. And next, I compare the magnitude of lateral force enhancement between small and large stretch condition. So in this study, so I defined the magnitude of lateral force enhancement as the difference between stretch and shortening cycle and pure shortening condition. And I found that larger magnitude of lateral force enhancement in a large stretch condition. So this result is in line with our previous experiment, confirms that effect of lateral force enhancement still exists even after shortening. And this is the main result of this study. So I calculate the mechanical work attained during the shortening phase. So this index is widely used for evaluating the effect of lateral stretch shortening cycle. And work enhancement was larger in the larger stretch condition, as well as the result of lateral force enhancement. So in summary, larger lateral force enhancement was observed in the larger stretch condition. And larger stretch shortened cycle effect was also observed in the larger stretch condition, as well as lateral force enhancement. So based on these results, lateral force enhancement seems to contribute to the stretch shortening cycle. However, so I have to mention the magnitude of this effect was not so large, about 4 to 5% increase, even in the very, very, very big stretch condition. In addition, several previous studies reported conflicting results. So finally, so I discussed the possible explanation for this contradiction. So the previous study conducting very similar experiment reported that the force at the end of active stretch was larger in the larger stretch condition as well as our study, but the magnitude of lateral force enhancement, so isometric force here, was not different among different stretch magnitude condition. So this result indicates that although the larger magnitude of lateral force enhancement was induced by different stretch magnitude condition, but this effect was completely eliminated by shortening. In addition, so several studies reported that the effect of stretch shortening cycle was completely eliminated after shortening. So one of possible explanation for this contradiction may be the difference in the operating region of muscle. So in concrete, so this study adopted relatively short muscle lengths. On the other hand, our study adopted relatively long muscle lengths. Here, I would like to introduce another characteristic of lateral force enhancement. The magnitude of lateral force enhancement is larger in the descending limb and smaller in the ascending limb. So if we conduct a stretch shortening cycle in the ascending limb, so it's difficult to expect larger magnitude of lateral force enhancement. But if we conduct stretch shortening cycle in the descending limb, we can expect larger magnitude of lateral force enhancement. So the contradiction among study may be caused by the difference in the operating region. So this idea is supported by the previous study examining the influence of operating region. So this study conducted similar length change pattern in ascending limb and descending limb condition. In the case of ascending limb, force in this region was similar between a pure shortening trial and stretch and shortening trial. On the other hand, in the case of descending limb, force responses in this region was always larger in the stretch and shortening cycle condition compared to the pure shortening condition. So the influence of lateral force enhancement on the stretch shortening cycle would be limited in the ascending limb while prominent in the descending limb. So finally, the answer to my question is yes, but the effect of lateral force enhancement on the stretch shortening cycle should be decreased by shortening because the effect of lateral force enhancement is attenuated by shortening and canceled out by lateral force depression. So to improve performance by lateral force enhancement, so inducing larger magnitude of lateral force enhancement and or decreasing the negative effect induced by shortening are important. And today's take-home message is, which exercise is better, machine leg press and 45 degree leg press? A hint is, so these pictures are the start position of each exercise. So generally speaking, machine leg press start from pushing phase and then braking phase. On the other hand, 45 degree leg press start from breaking phase and then pushing phase. So in other words, machinery press use non-enhanced concentric contraction, while 45 degree leg press can use enhanced concentric contraction. So thank you for your attention.
In relation to the drop jumps that you showed in the beginning. So if you think of like the medial gas cocks, it would normally be operating on the ascending limb. When you look at it, so that would be reduced regional force enhancement. So you think the drop jumps would use stretch working cycle or no?
Yeah. So in the case of human muscle and in the physiological range of motion, so as you know, probably not only medial gastrocnemius, but also lots of muscle use ascending limb or plateau region. So in the case of human muscle, so it may be difficult to expect larger magnitude of regional force enhancement. But so regarding the case of medial gastrocnemius, so I probably a lot of people believe medial gastrocnemius behave in the ascending limb only. But my idea is, because when I measure the magnitude of shortening of medial gastrocnemius fascicle length, so sometimes I confirm more than 50% of shortening. So this data indicates that, because if the medial gastrocnemius behave only in the ascending limb, probably 2 micrometer per sarcomere, so probably it can't shorten to 50%, because if medial gastrocnemius shorten 50% from 2 micrometer, so medial gastrocnemius should go to the 1 micrometer, which is much shorter than myosin filament length. So I'm not quite sure, but I have an idea. Maybe even human medial gastrocnemius behave in the descending limb. So maybe we can a little bit expect regional force enhancement.
So it seems that the faster the shortening, the greater effect you can see in a residual force enhancement with repeated or with stretch shortening cycles.
So you mean the speed of the shortening during the...
Yeah, so if you shorten more quickly, you get a greater benefit.
Yeah.
This suggests that people who are stronger could see more benefit than people who maybe not as strong and have to go through a motion over a longer time to maintain force?
Because the effect of regional force, so considering my data, effect of regional force enhancement decreased by the effect of regional force depression. And the effect of regional force depression should be small in the fast shortening condition. So I also expect, so in the case of if we conduct very quick shortening, so we can expect larger contribution of regional force enhancement on the stretch shortening cycle. Yeah.
All right, this is just a basic question. Mm-hmm. You said quick shortening reduces the work that's done. And I just was wondering what's the difference between quick shortening and slow shortening on work?
Yeah, so I, in this test, the duration of my quick shortening step is only 0.5 milliseconds, so which is much faster than cross bridge rotation. So in this case, so probably it's impossible to produce cross bridge force because the shortening of filament is much faster than this head. Yeah. So and if muscle fiber shorten within very very short duration, so the muscle fiber go to the negative region. So consider the x distance of Huxley. So if cross bridge form like this, so if cross bridge go beyond this region, so this cross bridge cannot produce force, and the detachment rate of cross bridge become much larger. So if the fiber shorten much faster than Crosby rotation, this Crosby should detach very, very quickly. So if we conduct very, very, very quick shortening step, yes, mechanical work must be very, very small.
Okay, so I guess you mean active cross-bridge work as opposed to presumably if the cross-bridge is not fast enough, then passive elastic things are performing the work.
In this case, yes, yes.
Yeah, the, work is, the total work is the same. It's just how much is active and how much is passive.
It's difficult. So first of all, so because we use really quick shortening, so 0.5 millisecond shortening. So I sampled the data with 10,000 hertz, but the data point it was only 5 points during shortening phase. So basically, it's at least in my experiment, it's difficult to calculate the mechanical work in my experiment. Yeah.
But presumably, it's so I'm assuming the the length is changing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The force is, I'm assuming, not changing by huge amounts. So there is work done, whether it's quick or slow shortening. It's just if it's very fast, the idea is that cross bridges cannot be performed.
Yes, I think so.
So something else is performing the work.
No, that's actually not quite correct. And you should never use that because, you know, according to force velocity relationship, when you do a quick shortening, force is going to be much, much lower during the shortening phase than when you do a slow shortening. So in a slow shortening, you will have much more work performed. So you go, you shorten this distance, but when you shorten slow, then you have a constant activation, force will be really big. If you shorten really fast, your force will be very, very low, and therefore the work.
Okay. So then the force is also dropping a lot during that
quick shortening.
Very short.
Quick shortening step. Yes.
It's, it's essentially zero. I'm not sure. You know, if you blew up that graph that he has, when you do quick shortening, force is in a half a millisecond, so you drop to zero, and then you do a lot of the shortening, essentially zero force. So
they
vary
the
short
and length,
the force will change as well.
What do you see?
I can
zoom in on. What do you turn
the
zoom in?
Yeah,
okay, yeah.
More power. So I have to slide.
Yeah,
no. Ah, this one. This one.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, okay. Yeah.
Good?
Yeah.
Because you can zoom in on
anything. Yeah. Okay, okay, thank you. Yeah. So this is a graph of the quick shortening step. Yeah. So this one.
Okay. So the blue shows that you are losing a lot of force.
Yes. Yes. Almost probably zero force. Yeah.
If you did that slowly, then the force would barely drop below the isometric.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Chris, I actually had a question about this graph while you're on it. The fiber that is starting at a longer length, I was curious why it wouldn't have a higher lower force before the shortening step.
Yeah, sorry. So this figure is only active force responses. So now I subtract the passive force from the total force.
Okay.
So yes, for example, in this blue line, the passive force here is higher compared to the this red line question.
But it's a good question, and the answer probably is that, you know, the force length relationship is not unique. So if you are at distinctly different lengths in the isometric contraction, you're right, one should be higher or lower if you're in the ascending limb or descending limb. But let's say if by accident he is, you know, we have the relationship like that, and he's on the ascending limb is the odd one, and slightly on the descending is the other, then the force could actually be similar. But you're right.
Yeah.
So maybe we just don't know exactly where the plateau is, or?
Here, this is on, you know, 3 and 3.3, that's on the descending limb. So that blue force, if it's purely active, should be low.
In my experience, so I conduct several tests with different muscle lengths. So theoretically, So in the case of rabbit psoas muscle, the isometric force should be maximum at 2.2 or 2.4 micrometer, and probably smaller in 3.0 micrometer. But sometimes, so I found almost same force even in 2.4 and 3.0 micrometer. One of my idea is, so once we stretch a skin fiber, the muscle and the diameter of muscle fiber become much smaller. So the distance between action and myosin becomes small, and the maybe the rate constant of attachment and detachment change. But I don't know the idea. So
another thing could also be that, you know, the way you get the active force is by subtracting the passive force, and usually people then go to 3 microns and 3.3 microns to get different passive force, and they subtract that. The problem that sometimes exists with that is that when you actually activate the muscle, you get a bit of shortening, and therefore the passive force that you subtract is usually overestimated from the passive force, and it's not, you know what I'm saying? Because you get a little bit of internal shortening usually. And therefore, you know, that it's actually not trivial to calculate the active force. Although people always do, you know, they're like, just subtract the passive force at the same length from the active force. But, you know, depending on where you are and how big passive forces are, that could be reasonably incorrect. And so it's not that trivial to actually do that.
Yeah. So this is a study examining the influence of lattice space on the isometric force. And when they decrease the lattice space by chemically decrease the lattice space, isometric force increases. So if we want to correctly evaluate the force length relationship, probably we have to strictly control the diameter of fiber, mass fiber.
So following up on those last questions, with that other graph you had up, I have two questions for that one. One is, are those two tracings from the same fiber? And the second question is, what's the PCA value, or the concentration of calcium during activation?
Okay. In my study, I always use a PCA 4.2, and so I use the same fiber. I use the same fiber, but I have to say, in the case of skin fiber, so once we induce a muscle contraction, so muscle force, if we conduct a second muscle contraction, muscle force decreases gradually, probably due to damage. So, yes, I use the same fiber, but the force generating capability may change. Yeah.
So, which one of the tracings did you do first in this case?
Yeah. So, in this case, I don't remember. But so in the paper, so to confirm this result, so I conducted reference isometric contraction, and then quick shortening step condition, and then reference isometric conduction again. So, and I compare the 2K. So, first reference isometric conduction and quick shortening step condition, and second reference isometric conduction and quick shortening step condition. So, and in both comparison, so I confirmed the same result. So I think the effect of sequence was not so large. Yeah.
I have a couple of questions. I was very intrigued by the Maruyama results that you showed, and because if I understood it correctly, you said actin and myosin was dissolved,
the skin fiber or a myofibril was stretched,
and then it came together, and the way I always thought about tightening, maybe that's not correct, is that, you know, it ends in the middle and goes in the M band, and then there's some proteins that connect it, but if you take the myosin away, those proteins would be wrong, then I would have assumed that you have two titins in the middle of the cell mm-hmm. that are not really connected. And so your titins wouldn't really attach anywhere. So I'm surprised that in that experiment.
But I think titin attached to the Z-line and M band. Is it correct?
Yeah, but
so,
you said the myosin was dissolved?
Yes, yes. So what is, so they...
But the M band was left intact from the myosin. So the myosin filament was partly dissolved. And so let's say the middle part, the M band, was still there. Because then it makes sense.
I see. Yeah, now I understand. Right, yeah.
That actually might be the... So, you know, when you said the myosin filament was gone, I thought it was just completely gone, and then I didn't see where they would actually hold on to.
Yeah. So now I just remember, so they eliminate the myosin filament by changing the ionic strengths.
Yeah.
So it says myosin filament dissolve. Sorry, I don't know the question now, sorry.
The other question that I had was, you know, and I think it goes a little bit to what Ian was mentioning at the beginning, because the residual force enhancement we think is long lasting, and it stays there for seconds and seconds, well, minutes in skin fibers, but we also know from, you know, Cavagna's work and other people's work that when you do a stretch, then you hold it for a couple of seconds and then you do the shortening, then you don't get any work enhancement in the stretch shortening cycle. So if you don't do stretch shortening, but you should stretch a couple of seconds of hold shortening, then that whole work enhancement is gone. But you
I don't think so. So even in the case of Cavagna experiments, so even if they keep the isometric state after stretch, and the force decreased to some extent, but after they shorten the fiber, so larger mechanical work was still observed in this condition.
But I actually didn't think that was the case. I thought he argues in his papers that there was not, but maybe I'm wrong. I mean, I haven't read those in 30 years probably. But the other thing that I do know, because we have done the experiments and you know it as well, is that when you do that, you know, you shorten right away, then you might have a certain amount of force enhancement like you show. But if you hold it and then shorten, then that force enhancement is typically gone. So how do you explain that? Because the residual force enhancement, you know, reaches a steady state, it's always the same, but there appears to be a time effect as well.
Yeah, so my answer is, so sorry, I don't have a good answer, but I know your paper and Raphael's paper, and report it, so if we have some duration between stretch and shortening, the effect of residual force enhancement was gone. Or if the shortening was relatively slow, the effect of residual force enhancement was gone.
It seems when you give it about more than 2 seconds in human anthropologists from the end of stretch to the end of shortening, then all these residual force enhancement effects seem to be gone.
So in my previous study using human plantar flexor, so I conducted basically almost same experiment. So I conducted stretch and shortening immediately after stretch, or wait 1 second and then shorten. And in this type of trials, the effect of residual force enhancement after shortening was gone in both condition, even in quick shortening condition, because my idea of this result was because human plantar flexor behave basically in the ascending limb. So in my case, after shortening, the plantar flexion angle is about plantar flexion 15 degrees, so which must be the very left part of the ascending limb. So this is the reason why I can't see the residual force enhancement. So if we conduct much longer lengths, so maybe I can see the difference between with rest or without rest. So I have to do that to confirm more.
This
sort of curiosity question. The one thing you showed, the Titan-based binding as a way to potentially explain the residual force enhancement. Is there any evidence of how much that of that binding occurs could vary a bunch, or is there any evidence, or is that just theoretical?
So how much means how this length of what?
Yeah, how much? Yeah. Like, could you be so much that you could even make it shorter so that would be a lot more stiff in that case?
So in previous study in Walter's laboratory, so Mike Duval used a Weibull technique. And in this region, so there's a specific protein, T2N, and they labeled this protein. And they found this when they stretch the muscle fiber in the residual force enhancement state. So this the elongation of this region becomes smaller. But I don't know the exact length of here. So sorry, now, so yeah, I don't have idea about how much titin attached to the actin.
So at the very beginning, you said, I think there were four potential mechanisms that you thought might be responsible for the work enhancement in the stretch shortening cycle. And then you know, the first one was stretch reflex, and then the second one was tendon elongation. So in human movement, do you think they play a role, or did you eliminate them because you think they don't play a role? Or
leisure force.
So stretch reflex and tendon elongation, because you just mentioned once and then said, I'm not going to talk about them. But what role do they play?
The weakest point to discuss this point is, so in the case of human dynamic movements, so sometimes muscle fascicles behave isometrically due to the elongation of tendon. So if muscle fascicles really behave isometrically during stress shortening cycle, probably we can't expect the effect of residual force enhancement. So also it depends on the fascicle behavior during stress shortening phase.
But you know, you mentioned you stretch reflex.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, so.
I thought with stretch reflex, you meant a reflex activation.
So.
Do you think there's a reflex activation with eccentric exercise that helps in the context?
Yeah, as same as leisure force enhancement. So, the role of stretch reflex in the human dynamic movement is not so substantial. For example, in my previous laboratory, Dr. Kawakami reported that during stress shortening cycle, basically fascicles keep isometrically. So in their paper, so they said the effect of stretch reflex would be neglected or very small.
But
did
they measure EMG, for example, at the same time, or?
Yes, they measured. And probably, I don't remember EMG did not change, I think. But I don't think
so. Yeah. The EMG didn't change, at least qualitatively, meaning that there's no stretch reflex effect. You didn't get a much bigger EMG in the shortening phase, but you had a stretch phase.
And my answer idea is, so if we assume stretch reflex contribute to the stretch shortening cycle in human, so in this case, so in the without stretch shortening cycle condition, in this squat jump condition, if we can activate all motor unit even in this condition, stretch reflex has no effect, because even in the without facilitating effect, we can activate all motor unit. In this case, I think effect of stretch reflex has negligible.
But you know, even if you have all motor units activated, let's say if they were all activated at 40 hertz, and then when you do a stretch, they would be activated at 60 or 70 hertz, you still would expect that would actually contribute to a greater activation of more force. So even if you have all motor units activated, because you can also vary the force
by the frequency. Frequency. So if in the normal jump, activate all motor unit with sufficient frequency, so probably we can't expect the effect.
And tendon?
Yeah, That's a
tendon,
yeah.
Is the second thing.
Yeah.
You think tendon helps or?
Also, lots of paper and lots of research suggests so tendon has a big effect on the threshold in cycle. So, but in the case, so if we have a relatively short tendon with respect to the muscle fascicle, so in this case, maybe the effect of tendon elongation is not so large. But if we have very long tendon relative to the muscle fascicle, such as tachy, so in this case, probably the tendon elongation contributes the threshold cycle substantially because the magnitude of elongation, absolute value of elongation is larger in this condition.
The turkey you think about, the Roberts paper.
Yes, yeah.
Yeah, but, you know, ERA would argue because they use actually strain gauge because they say they need on a calcified tendon that essentially doesn't elongate. Because when you have a strain gauge on a tendon, it immediately rupture because you cannot measure such big. So essentially you have no length change there because the tendon is long, but it's also calcified and I guess it doesn't really elongate at all, or just, you know, microns.
Yeah, so of course if tendon does not elongate, so we can't expect, so.
What about kangaroos, you know?
Kangaroos.
Famous studies where, you know, kangaroos go at increasing speeds and supposedly the oxygen uptake supposedly stays about the same.
Yeah.
Can that be explained?
And now some of my Japanese friends try to measure the Achilles tendon behavior in Kenyan marathon runner.
Yeah.
Because so from the photo, so it is clear they have very small muscle relative to the Achilles tendon. So in this case, the effect of tendon elongation should be very substantial or significant. So it's strongly related to the tendon lengths, I think. Anyway.
Arden, I was just curious what the effect of temperature is on residual force enhancement and stretch shortening, and I presume it's a similar effect.
As far as I know, so the effect of temperature on the residual force enhancement has not been examined. If the temperature changes substantially, such as 10 degrees, maybe the cross-bridge behavior changes. So cross-bridge, the chemical reaction becomes much slower. So this might affect the result, but sorry, now I don't know the effect of temperature.
It's actually an interesting question because temperature supposedly biases the cross-bridge more towards the meat rebound state. And Jean Lee once did a study, you know, he's tremendously different temperatures, but I think 10, 15, and 20 degrees. And looked at that, but to my shame, I have to admit, I don't remember the results. But I think that has been done actually.
Okay, sorry, I don't check that. So
yeah,
I'll check. Sorry.
John? This is a question from the web. It's, do you think the greater force enhancement, this refers to the picture that you've got where the person's doing the leg press. So, and the question is, do you think the greater force enhancement in the 45 degree leg press would lead to greater training stimulus compared to the machine leg press? In other words, does force enhancement affect training stimulus?
Okay, so the last slide is a little bit tricky. So this first of all, I have to say, so this idea is just can be applied only in the first reps, because from the second reps, so imagine even in machine leg press condition, so second reps start from here after eccentric contraction, so we can use enhanced pushing even in machine leg press from second reps. Sorry.
Any more questions for Atsuki? One last question. Did you use your research to be able to lift 100 kilograms on the bench press?
The bench press starts from this portion. So I So I feel the weight during lengthening phase.
So can you have the 100 kilo weight on your chest and be steady and then push and actually do it?
Oh.
Or do you have to have the eccentric phase to be able to do it?
If I stop 100 kilo here, probably I can't lift. Yeah, so yeah, this result clearly shows that.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
All right, let's do it again. Okay, so next week we'll have Dr. Ian Smith present, and he was the past moderator of the Musculoskeletal Biomechanics Seminar, and he'll share his research with the very intriguing title, Tales of Mice and Men and Some Frogs. Are there differences in the way our muscles relax? See you next week.